hard you try, you can't stop us now. No matter how hard you try, you can't stop us now.
Hey, everybody. Thank you so much for having me. It has been quite an exciting couple days. Connecting with all of you has been really special. There's been so many people I wanted to have longer conversations with, so I'm hoping for the duration of the event I'll be able to connect and spend more time with those of you that are interested in what I promote and educate about. I'm not someone that would have ever guessed I'd be doing this. My husband and I said we'd never have kids. We were together since I was 15 and he was 17. We came together through our mutual desire to do and end with school. We would hide in the bathroom during classes together, smoke cigarettes, smoke weed out in the back of the school. We were total rebels from the beginning, and little did I know what we'd go on to do. I have four kids. By the way, Joe and I have been married 20 years this June. I have four children. My son, Devin, is almost 16. I have a daughter, Tiffany, who's 13. Ivy, my daughter, who's in the audience and came with me for this amazing trip, was 10. And then I have a son, Orion, named after the Metallica song, who's 7. It's really hard in half an hour to sum up the philosophy of radical unschooling and peaceful parenting. I'm going to do my best for you. But I want to encourage you to think of freedom in new ways. So a lot of things I might share with you in regards to parenting might be new to you. I think it resonates deeply with people, and I like to say that I'm just bringing forth what you know already, deep down, in your instinct. And it tends to trigger people because I like to say to people, the things you were feeling when you were young, I am here now to say that you were right. You were living injustice when your parents punished you. It's been an evolution for me not to blame parents, because you only know what you know. And I believe in my heart that most people are doing the best they can with what they know. And I try to assume positive intent. It can be really hard for people to step into this realm of peaceful parenting because sometimes it means admitting that you were abused or treated unjustly, and a lot of people don't want to face that. That's too painful. I had a great talk on Thursday. I did a full day workshop, which I was late for, sorry. I'm not used to clocks, schedules. We made up for it, though. Everybody was really cool about it. It was an emotional experience. I saw a lot of people crying. I tried hard to hold back tears, because I think parenting can be a really, real healing journey for people. There's two components to radical unschooling. One is the educational component, which I think you guys totally get. You've probably heard most of it. I'm here to share a little bit more detail how to facilitate a child's learning without force or coercion. I personally am against forced learning of any kind. I think this philosophy, a few people have told me, is the missing link. And I'm just a messenger of this information. I didn't invent it. In fact, people have been unschooling since the beginning of time. It's only recently that schools and education came into play in the course of human history. So I feel like this is a really evolved approach. However, it's really instinctual and primitive at the same time. The other component that's really challenging for people is the peaceful parenting side. How do you live without punishments? How do you live without force or control? Freedom to me looks very different than it might to some people. I don't push my agenda on my children. I do educate them, and they know what I'm passionate about, what my morals and values are. However, they are free to have their own. My daughters and I are vegan. My son is a hunter. He is into primitive skills. He is probably the most radical of all my kids. I don't know why that is, but that's who he is. He's building a house on our property with his bare hands to live on, and he wants to live on the land, and he believes in eating animals, and I totally respect that. So much so I will cook for him, whatever he wants me to, even with my morals and values. I tend to not fit in anywhere because of that. The vegans hate me. You know, I get crap from them because I allow my kids to eat meat. It can be a really isolating place to respect your children. I shared a story about judgment in my workshop that has been definitely a journey for me because when I first became an advocate, well, let me start back with my birth. For one, I never knew I could have a natural birth, ever. I feel like I was the biggest wuss ever. I cried when I got my first tattoo. The tattoo artist was like, sick of me by the end of the session. He's like, get the hell out of my chair. I can't even handle you. So I thought when I gave birth, it would be so hard, but I had a hospital birth, which was the only hospital birth I had. And I had a midwife supporting me, which was pretty radical not to hire a doctor. And when I did it, I held my son and I couldn't believe there was really a human inside me. You're pregnant and your belly's growing, but it's such a weird concept when you've lost yourself growing up that you could actually grow a human life. Well, I gave birth to him and it was so surreal. I held him. I still remember the way it felt when he was warm and wet. Those mothers, remember that feeling of you just can't believe it? And so I was looking into his eyes and the nurses all came into the room and they turned the TV on, which was really strange actually to me, but something amazing and scary and powerful happened is as they turned the TV on, the Columbine shootings were happening live. I was watching children be killed within seconds of bringing forth life. And it was during that time that this block of thought just hit me that how many of these parents that were losing kids and how many of these kids would have rather been home that day, but they didn't know they had the choice. In that very moment, I decided that my children will always, always have the choice where they want to be, and that includes school. They still have the freedom to choose school or not. However, they kind of laugh about it because they say, why on earth would we ever choose to be in prison? Why would we ever choose to need to raise our hand to go to the bathroom and have to obey things we don't agree with? In that moment of holding my son on the day of Columbine, I wasn't fearful of sending my kids to school because they'd get shot. Just something was born within me that realized that children were one of the most discriminated people in our culture today. And somebody had to start educating others and supporting other people with children's rights. To me, that starts with birth. When you are able to give birth under your own power, something is born within you when your child is born that connects with all the generations behind you of women that can do this and could bring birth. Bring forth a life naturally. I wrote another book called Sexy Birth, and it's kind of the prequel to Radical Unschooling because I think a lot of people need to understand that birth is a sexual experience. You guys have heard about orgasmic birth. That's not really what I'm talking about. I didn't quite have that experience, although those that did, right on. However, my second birth is a home birth. I realized that the institution of a hospital was a money-making business, and they caused the very complications that they manipulate women into believing they're fixing. I'm a doula. I've attended hundreds of births, and I've seen it. I educate people about circumcision, and I'm proud to say I have saved over 200 penises from being mutilated. But that came with my mistake of not knowing with my first child, allowing the doctor to take him away out of my arms and do that to him. No one told me. I didn't know. And it was my only parenting regret, although I'm healing from the regret by having another son and proudly leaving him intact. I talked to my son a couple years ago about him being circumcised. I had to, and just apologized. And he said, why are you crying? It's okay. I don't remember. And I said, well, there is surgery you can get to have your foreskin reattached. He said, Mom, it's okay. Don't worry about it. I understand. He said, I was happy being your training child, like, but I had to practice on to get things right. Sometimes our biggest mistakes in life are our biggest teachers, and they propel you forth to make such a huge difference in this world. I'm sure we've all, everyone that's a parent has made them. I think it's so essential to feel that contrast of emotion from doing something that's out of alignment with how you truly are to then make a decision that feels good. Parenting is supposed to feel good by nature. And everything promoted to us in our culture, from experts, from the media, makes it a really miserable experience. Shows like Super Nanny, Nanny 911 is all candy-coated, sweet child training, which is very similar to dog training. I was supposed to be on the Oprah show with Joe Frost, like her and I head to head. Oprah, they came to our house for 12 hours and filmed us, and something happened in the news and the show was canceled. I don't know how that would have gone, but I was excited to do it. I just like to believe that our culture's not quite ready. But we're getting there. We've done a lot of work in the media, and the first show we were ever on was the Dr. Phil show 9 years ago. I didn't know we were going to be on stage with Dr. Phil. In fact, I think we were slightly sabotaged, but I did pretty well considering it was my first appearance. Coming up here actually reminded me of that, because I remember sitting on stage and looking out at everybody and feeling woozy. That was the beginning of our journey in the media that I wasn't expecting. And it was really rejected by a lot of people. It was a really powerful experience to do it, but Dr. Phil understood. He did. You wouldn't see that on the show, but during all the commercial breaks, he would look over at me with his fake white teeth and pounds of makeup and say, "You're doing real good, darling. You're doing real good." I gave him a copy of my book, and then he called me about a month later to ask me to return on the show as a guest expert, speaking out against crying it out. That was an incredible experience as well. Crying it out is when you let a baby cry itself to sleep. That's something that we've never done. We've always co-slept with our kids. Can you believe none of our kids have ever slept in the crib? Because they have wanted to be close to us at night. So we started parenting with the family bed. We probably have the biggest bed in the world, by the way. My son, Devin, and my daughter, Tiffany, are now in their own rooms. They've always had their own rooms, but they've always had the choice and freedom to sleep where they want. Mothers and babies are designed to be together at night. And I like to say that parenting doesn't end just because the stars are out. I never regret co-sleeping. It has been the most amazing experience. But people ask me all the time, well, how are you intimate with your husband? And I say, we have four kids, so you find a way. It's kind of like the energy you had when you were a teenager, and you would find a way, right? Your parents told you not to, don't shut that door. You'd find a way. It's that same energy you're going to tap into. And I said on the Dr. Phil show that if you're only having sex in your bed, I kind of feel bad for you. Well, we've gone into advocating in the media on other shows like Nightline. Juju Chang came to our house. The funny thing about the media is these people are really cool when they're with you. They're really nice and they get it. She was like, wow, I'm actually parenting this way, but once those cameras are on, the true agenda comes forth, and the final product is sometimes not at all what you were hoping it would be. However, I keep saying yes, and I keep taking every opportunity that comes to us because the people that are ready to hear it connect, no matter how the show goes. So many people have connected with me, even with the worst example of who we are. People love to really pump up in the media. No rules, no punishments. But rarely do they share what we are for. What we're for is children's rights and freedoms and living in a partnership-based paradigm. 99% of parenting advice on the market today is geared to meet the parents' needs only. The parents' needs for quiet, uninterrupted sleep, compliance and obedience. And we are told that we are abusing our kids if we don't control them. That fascinates me. But most of us, the only thing we've ever known is control, or we've known people who are completely like permissive and hands-off. So we think if we're not controlling or punishing, that we must be completely hands-off, permissive, and not connected. Peaceful parenting is very different. It's a very hands-on approach. I like to say that rules are a replacement for being there. That's an important thing to really take in and understand. I've said things that people have gone to write major hate emails to me, such as rules are a replacement for being there and rules are for lazy parents. This is the kind of energy I always feel. I could feel people in resistance. It's amazing when you say these types of things at times because people want to know what to do instead. So what do you do instead of forcing your child to obey you and having rules? You're present. And you focus on the needs under the behavior. Most of the parenting advice is focused on behavior, behavior modification, controlling behavior. We do not focus on behavior with our children. We focus on, again, the needs under the behavior. And you guys have all heard the saying, children learn what they live. People say it all the time without realizing that they're not living it. Well, children learn what they live as far as freedom. And we focus on the needs of our kids as much as our own. Now, it is hard sometimes to lay all the needs of everybody in the family on the table to find a solution that meets everybody's needs equally, respectfully, and peacefully. But we are modeling to them a mini microcosm of world peace. What happens when, even using gentle discipline techniques, children grow up thinking that power rules, because that's what they've had modeled to them. They go around trying to control other people even subtly. Timeouts may be gentler than spanking, but they're in the same paradigm of the authoritarian approach. I offer parenting coaching, and I think some of the biggest things people struggle with are freedom with media, freedom with foods, and freedom with bedtimes. Those are the big hot topics that over and over again I help people with, because there's a lot of fear with these things. There's a lot of fear giving kids food freedom. Do you know why? Because as children, you were never trusted. And so you grow up not trusting yourselves, and therefore not trusting others, and not trusting children is a really, really hard thing. However, when you do, when you trust kids to self-govern, and you trust children to make choices that are inherently good for themselves, which they do, you'd be blown away with seeing what choices children make that aren't damaged, you know, or damaging. My children have never had bedtimes. They go to bed when they're tired. Side effect is they've never had sleep issues of any kind. They go to bed like we do. When we're tired, we go to bed and we sleep until we're done in the morning, and in turn, they're very, very healthy. They very rarely get sick because they're able to sleep and tune into their bodies in ways that most people can't. They make really amazing choices with food, and they pretty much always have. I nursed them until they were done, which was another huge issue for many people, and I never thought I would be one of those moms, one of the hippie moms that have a toddler attached to their breast. Not only did I have a toddler, but I had a baby. I tandem nursed. I nursed through pregnancies. And when my children outgrew the need, they were done. After giving birth, naturally, I went on to become a childbirth teacher because I wanted to help other women have that experience. I had two home births and midwives, and the last birth that I had with my son Orion, who is now 7, was an unassisted birth. I gave birth alone to an 11-pound baby because the trust that I had within myself and the measures that I had intact in case of anything happening made me feel very safe. My husband Joe and I, when I was in labor with Orion, we played around a little. Crazy, huh? Birth is a continuum of sexuality, and I write about that in my book, Sexy Birth. I never knew about it. I thought it was this emergency waiting to happen before I had kids. In my birthing classes, I like to tell guys, how well would you perform if you were being intimate with your partner, if you were in a hospital room under fluorescent lights, being monitored, your heart was being monitored the whole time. People were encouraging you to finish and saying things like, you're almost there, dude. Come on, you can do it. How well would you perform with your partner? Really feel that. Think about it. It is the same with birth. It's the same exact continuum of sexuality. So when you're giving birth, you have to have the same energy that you conceived the baby with. So we connected a little bit in the beginning, and then I said, I really need to be alone. Privacy is really important. So I went into our bedroom, and I cranked as loud as I can, Rage Against the Machine. My son Orion was born into my arms, 11 pounds.
No matter how hard you try, you can't stop us now. No matter how hard you try, you can't stop us now.
I don't think you start learning until you finish school.
Yeah, me too.
Well, traditional education.
Yes, at school at most.
Exactly. Well, you do learn a lot, but it's not necessarily things of value. You learn
memorize.
You learn how to cheat. You learn how to lie. You learn how to manipulate really well.
Really well.
You learn how to be inauthentic. You learn how to be fake. You learn how to appear to be somebody you're not. So you do learn a lot. You really do. But it's not what the intention is of learning. And so. Kind of looking at learning for what it is, and everybody finally in our culture being honest with each other for what really happened to them and what we're all going through, what we're continuing our kids, forcing to continue them to do. So as far as control, we talked about food, we talked about media. There are times as an unschooling parent you are challenged to expand income. There was a time where Devin was, I think, like 7, and my husband was really into the show CSI. And he was watching it and talking about it, and my son Devin said, I really want to watch it. And I was kind of like, I don't want to see Devin. He was like, it was part of me. Like, I'm way past that now because I have Iron Man and Walking Dead. So as you can see, I've gone on quite a journey, but
with Devin, being my precious little, you know, firstborn, I was just like, I don't know, I don't feel comfortable enough about you seeing dead bodies and like the murders and so forth that takes place in the show. And he said, my husband's actually said, I'll watch it with him and I'll be there to explain things. I'll be a resource. And Devin said, no, I'm fine. I feel comfortable watching it. I'm ready. And so that night I went to bed and the two of them stayed up and they watched like 3 episodes. And for one, it was a great time for them to connect. And for two, what the fascinating thing was, you know, I woke up like, what'd you think? And I was like, well, they weren't dead bodies. They were actors pretending they were dead.
Yeah.
And, well, we went to a yard sale like 2 days later and we found this like forensics, CSI forensics kit. With this model kit and you like take clay and form, you figure out how to make dead bodies' faces, I guess, to identify them. There's a lot that goes into forensics. It's really not my interest, so I know I sound dumb talking about it probably, but we found a real passion in that for a long time. It led to so many different avenues of learning from me and so many different interests that branched off of that one interest in me saying yes and supporting him. So no matter what it is, even in the beginning, if it seems like a valid thing to limit or control, any kind of limiting or control limits learning, period. So if you want your kids to learn less, control or limit something that you're fearful of. Because you don't know what direction they're going to take it in, do you?
So to understand the concept, you basically let your kid do whatever they want, and then don't worry about, like, you know, I'm afraid, I have a 2.5-year-old. Mm-hmm. He loves to learn, and that's great. But I want him to also be outside and stuff like that, but he prefers to be watching TV. So whatever it is they want to do, just don't worry about it and kind of let it go.
Well, it's important to first ask you, have you ever limited TV?
What's that?
Have you ever limited TV? Or controlled TV?
No, only when, you know, we're in an environment where it's not appropriate. And, but no, if we're at home and he wants to do that, then
yeah,
and he's watching, I mean,
yes,
nothing bad. I mean, it's not like I'm worried about that.
I would fully support that. There is a point where you think you're not limiting or controlling. Let's talk about this a little deeper. This is kind of more the spiritual component, that you may physically not be limiting or controlling, but if you are looking at something that you are not happy with your kids doing, I'm not saying you're doing this, but I'm just putting this out here for you to understand. Things are limited and controlled in your kid's life if you judge them as negative and they know it. Our kids are very, very intuitive. They feel what we're feeling. My daughter, Ivy, will know the second she said, what's wrong, mom? And I'll give them fine. And she'll be like, no, I can tell. You're different. You sound different. When you have this trusting relationship and connection, like you have with your kids, and you're not really approving of anything, or you're trying to pull them away from something they know, and it'll hold on to it longer, and it does work the relationship. So say that you're like, come on, buddy, you want to play with me? Your kids know whether you authentically want to play or if you're trying to get them away from the TV. This type of parenting makes you line up with authenticity hardcore, because your kids will call you on it. These kids are fine wired when it's intact and they're whole to know when they're not being honest. And you might not even know you're not being honest. That's the funny thing. That's how screwed up we are in some ways, that we don't even recognize it until they bring it to our attention. You're like, wow, I was trying to do that. I didn't even realize it. We're on automatic pilot a lot of times for how we were raised, and our fear guides us in really strange directions in authenticity.
But what about like certain limits? Like, for example, cell phones, they say in the manual, it's not safe for children under a certain age because they give off radiation. So he sees my cell phone,
true that,
and I really
it's not
don't.
It's safe to watch the idiot box either. That's why they call it television programming.
Well, yeah, but I'm just saying specifically, like, the radiation from a cellular phone is not safe for anyone, but specifically little kids.
Okay, I'm
going to
talk about both of those things. They're both really important, okay? So for one, because we don't limit and control, we have that trusting relationship. When I give my kids information without fear, just information like that, they believe me.
Right.
Why wouldn't they? I've never tried to manipulate them or control them. Before we go into a grocery store when they were little, I would say, people don't really, you know, this isn't a place where we generally run around. People get upset. There's, you know, you need to be respectful and just, here's a grocery list. And they say, okay, that's cool, thank you. If they have energy, I'll take them to run around, but they know that the grocery store is a place where people would get upset with that. I don't say you're not going to get to watch TV later. I don't threaten them. I don't coerce them. I give them information as if they were a foreign exchange student coming to a new land. Say you travel to Saudi Arabia and they just let you know, just so you know, Lisa, when you do show the soles of your feet, you have the freedom to show them the bottom of your feet, but just so you know, it doesn't offend anymore. Why on earth would you ever do it? Like, really, if you knew consciously it offended somebody, unless somebody said, if you do this, you're going to be in a lot of trouble. You're like, fuck you. I'm scared. It's like, what control and limiting does to our human psyche. It's like the psychology behind it is really important to understand. So my kids would want to know that information if I would say, we've talked about that. My daughter will not let me use my cell phone without the headset.
Mm-hmm.
They call me out on stuff. Or, well, you know that's not safe. No, use this. So you give them information.
And I'm with you. Well, the only problem is he's not at the point where he can process that information yet.
Okay,
so.
Well, let's talk about that. Then what need does he have? Like, one thing that's really important to understand about this type of parenting is traditional parenting. Like, 99% of the parenting books on the market are focused on obedience and compliance and meeting the parent's needs. That's not exaggerated. You guys really think about it. Shows like Nanny 911, even the more gentle parenting stuff, it's all about behavior modification. How to get the kids to do what you want and control and manipulate their behavior. That's an excruciatingly frustrating place to be as a child, like a lot of us grew up. And it's promoted by experts and doctors to control your kids. They're focused on the parents' needs solely of uninterrupted sleep, quiet, and again, conforming and compliance and obedience. However, what this type of parenting is focusing on the needs under the behavior. That's a huge, profound awareness to have. Now, there's a lot of people that talk about this now. Alfie Cohen, he's a teacher who writes about something called unconditional parenting, and he's done a lot of research on this type of thing. That's fascinating to me. When you focus on the needs under the behavior, it dissipates the behavior. So if he's playing with your phone, it's really important, and he's not, could you get him a phone that's not active? I mean, if that was me, I'd be like, he has interest in cell phones, I'll just get him one that's not, you know, hooked up to something. And,
right.
And let him be limiting your data.
Yeah.
At a 2-year-old level, he might just be doing easy.
So it sounds like there is some fear, which is totally warranted. I understand you being like, I don't want to be doing that. I don't want it to get, you know, it's not porn or whatever. So get him a cell phone that doesn't have service. It's pretty simple. Or what other need, you know, do you think? So you brainstorm with your partner, brainstorm, laying in bed. I do that all the time. Like, what is the need? How can I, you know, worry so little?
Yeah.
Would that be a solution that might work?
In my case, it's a little different because I think his mom had told her not to let her do it, but she uses the YouTube on the phone, so he's used to watching videos on it. That's why. So it's kind of hard.
Well, I mean, yeah,
it's,
so you're separated from his
mom.
That can cause some glitchy energy, isn't it? It's hard. It's a whole different kind of thing when you've got that other parent who has different beliefs, different ideas, isn't it?
Yeah.
I do personal coaching if you're ever interested to like really delve deep into your particular situation.
Yeah.
But there could be a lot of issues that trigger you based on your feeling toward her that we then like kind of project onto our kids. So there might be other stuff there for you that is being kind of triggered of her not respecting you and your choices, which makes you really upset when he does certain things. So it's important just to really kind of hold out the feelings behind it. Could you, if he loves YouTube, could you get another source of YouTube for him to watch instead of on the phone? It's really YouTube.
Yeah, well, that's where the TV comes in.
Okay. Somebody have a question? So I can't
figure it out. Wi-Fi is also a new kind of free. If it's further away, which we have an advanced for data, that's normally what's not recommended. But if it's
going
to be better, it's better. Yeah. Sorry, can you speak?
The Wi-Fi is a different kind of radiation than the kind that you would use during a cell phone call. And if it's not, what's not recommended is keeping it against your head all the time.
Right.
It's a little bit further away, and it is a little different.
Totally different. But for Wi-Fi, not cellular, specifically.
For all radiation, basically.
Yeah.
It's close up, it's like an inverse curve, so you move a little bit further away, it drops off dramatically.
Yeah, exactly.
These are low power, these are like a micro bulb power, you know, like 5 watts, I think is the max, which is in the bulb would be nothing. But it's still, you're right, next to the brain, bad idea.
It actually uses your skull as an antenna.
Can do that.
That's so what we're
focused,
hearing.
Okay, so focused on his needs. What are his true needs? And how can you find him and have those needs met in a safer way?
Right.
Instead of like the forbidding or just don't focus on that. And I think once you shift the energy and you just say, yeah, buddy, I want you to be able to watch that, and you find another resource for it, or are you following me? You seem a little resistant.
I'm resistant?
No, are you
No,
frustrated?
I was just
okay.
Thinking that a good idea would be to download some stuff like on an iPad so we would have that option.
So then the issue is not really about the phone, it's about finding it in ways to meet his needs in a different way. And then the like problem goes away. In time, continue building the relationship, I'll be more understanding to your fears, and then you could brainstorm together. I think that's an important aspect of, the kids get a little older, you're able to say, you know, the radiation, the cell phone's really wigging me out. It's not healthy for you. I know you want to do this, but like, do you have any ideas on how we can meet your need while respecting the fact that I can't let you do something that's freaking me out? Like,
right, or obviously, like, you can't pick up a knife, or, you know, there are certain things that you kind of have to step in. But you let them.
Ivy was 18 months old when she started helping me in the kitchen.
Uh-huh.
Okay, so I want to honor where all of you are at in your own space. If you're present and you're there, you can find ways to meet a child's needs safely. She started with a butter knife at 18 months old that wasn't sharp because she wanted to cut things.
Right.
So you focus on the need, because when you're fearful, it just shuts you down from creativity of finding ways to meet your kids' needs. I've seen it happen. You just are like, oh my God, no knife, kids, let's go do this. And you distract and do something else. You say, oh, you want to help me? Is that what you want to do? And then you just pull a chair over. Get a safer knife that's not a sharp blade, and you say, here, cut this cucumber. Cucumbers are great to cut through. So what is the need for the knife? Is it to be present with you in the kitchen? Is it to, and then you find safer ways. So there's always a way to say yes, in a way that meets both of your needs for both safety. You being present is really important, and their needs to explore, grow, and learn. Playing with knives is really primitive. That's a natural, same with fire. I mean, these kind of things we see, the kids see adults doing, and it looks really interesting and fun and expansive, and they want to do it. So you find safe ways to do it. As far as the TV, you're calling it the idiot box. Again, I personally, I respect where your stance is, and I know it's a greater majority of our culture believes that. Maybe a greater majority of our subculture, I should say. Because a great majority of our culture is very like pop culture. I do want to say, it has to do so much in our lives that it's like has to do with the intent of use. Okay? Intent, the energy of intent is something can look the same in one house as another, completely different because the intent of use is different. When I was a little girl, being forced in school, I couldn't wait to get home and plop on the couch and turn on Brady Bunch and zone the hell out for 2 hours.
That's right.
Did I really want to watch that show? I just wanted to do something I chose to do. I wanted to decompress and I wanted freedom. And so I did like zone out for this movie as a healing tool. There wasn't a lot to do back in the space 70s and 80s. We had an Atari, but that was pretty much it. So TV was a tool that I used to decompress. Our kids use TV as a tool for learning. They have total freedom to use it, just as I do right now. So the intent of use is to learn. We watch Man vs. Wild together. For example, Devin was really into, he's still really into primitive survival. And so I feel like watching as a tool of connection as a family is the same benefits as like reading a book together, if not more so. It really brings us together. Any tool of connection that we can have fun with, and our kids are making a conscious choice to watch something because of a reason. I really love some cooking shows. So I love to watch those to learn and grow. I love watching design shows. I love like international vacation shows, like My Second Home in like Australia. And I fantasize and I put it on my vision board. I dream about it. So I think TV, it can be a window into our world and a tool for great learning with that intention. When it's used in the same way as some people have categorized as a drug to decompress and just to like get away from the real world or to be free, you know, feel freedom. I know any negative effects can come from that kind of tool. So.
The negative effects are from, like, the causes why you need to decompress. I mean, that's the negative effect. You have the need. So, the TV is just a drug. So, the drug is it's the symptom.
It's a great way to explain it. That's a self-fulfilled prophecy. A lot of times, like, it happens like that. So, it's important not to write off TV as a tool for learning. In fact, if I would have limited TV or forbidden TV, my kids would not know what they know on so many levels. Devin would have never introduced to so many concepts, it can be an amazing window to our world. I love Anthony Bourdain. Do you guys know who he is? What's the first thing I did knowing I was coming to Mexico? I jumped on YouTube, watched Anthony Bourdain episodes about Mexico. I love the way he articulates cultures and he introduces you to the food. I have like manifested so many opportunities through like watching something and then setting the intention of I want to do that. It's a very personal issue. I realize that everybody has different morals and values, and I respect what they are until they're forced upon somebody else.
Yes.
So I think that's an important thing to remember, that just because you feel TV isn't necessarily good for you, it it's important to respect your children if they are using it as a tool and try to work with it.
Well, in all fairness, that's a bit generalizing. The intent behind what I mentioned is that the majority of the stuff on the TV is meant to dumb you down or to program you into the zombie that just receives information as opposed to being creative on your own.
That's so important to say.
And there's also the physical sense of it that I can't explain it. Maybe someone else in here knows more about it than I do, but it's whatever's coming off of the screen, however that they program this from a satellite.
Flashing of the lights or something it's pretty deep.
And it like literally has a physiological effect on your brain and your ability to process thoughts normally. And so that was the second part of it. And then the third part of it is coming from the States myself, I can say for a fact, like everybody I know, they just sit their kid in front of the boob tube and that's like the babysitter. So I say that with a word of caution that, you know, you gotta kind of be conscientious of all of the deleterious effects that this has on your kid, not just your kid, but your even anybody really that watches. My grandparents called it the boob tube, and then my parents called it the idiot box, and then I heard somebody else call it the intellectual reduction something or other like that. But yes, of course there are educational programs on the television, but by and large I feel that it's not a healthy thing to engage in, you know, unless you're going to sit and watch, like you said, one program on one particular channel that's meant to educate, you know, or teach you about some other culture or that kind of thing.
Let's just delve a little deeper in two components of what you said. The first thing is what I said before, I personally would never call it the Jody box, and then that's really disrespectful to me because my kids do it. Now it's kind of like putting something on that's not reality or truth for my own personal experience. I know that cultures have called it that for years since TV came. TV is actually pretty relatively new historically. People were petrified of it when it first came out. But the same thing happened with radio. When radio first came out, people were petrified of it. They were told that they could sit in front of it and they could just do this.
With the internet.
The internet, the same things. I did. The same thing's happening. I don't buy into that particular philosophical perspective, but I respect your stance, and I know a lot of people do. Only because my own personal experience has not reflected any of it, nor the experience of my kids. So I like to go on my own personal experience rather than studies or propaganda that's anti-anything. When I first had kids and we researched Waldorf philosophy, for example, my philosophy was deeply, deeply rooted in anti-TV propaganda. And I respect where you're at, but I haven't found that personally in my own personal experience from what people are saying. However, I do agree with you very much with the fact that if a child is conditioned to not trust themselves and to take orders from authorities, hell yeah, TV's influential. You've been dumbed down to listen to other people instead of yourself. Yeah. That's never happened to my kids. They would never be influenced by things that most kids are, because they haven't been told to do that. We're telling our kids to do that. Our culture is telling our children to not trust themselves, so listen to authorities while they, you know, see these people they look up to on TV. They're going to do what they say. Yeah, TV's influential. It can be damaging when you tell your child to not listen to who they are. So it's important to kind of break that down, that when a child's never been conditioned to take orders and to listen to somebody else and they're encouraged to be themselves, they look at it and view it and take it in very differently. And I've personally experienced that with my own kids.
And ideally, everybody could have a family, like, you know, and every kid could be like hers. Everybody would be homeschooled and nobody would be that little square peg trying to fit into a round hole.
So the damage is real. And I wanted to break it down and share with you on another level why that doesn't come that's definitely important. Commercials, for example, around Christmas. We never really watch commercials either, like TiVo. We just watch what we want. It's a very controlled TV. It doesn't control us. I think the opportunity to do that is really important. But sometimes we like to watch commercials. Isn't that weird that we like to see what's out there and available? And there's times I bought one of those inflatable bombs before, and we bought it and got it. Couldn't wait to use it, and it broke. And it was such a great learning experience for my kids to be like, yeah, they don't do what they say on the commercial, do they? And so there's been times where we learn so much through that experience. And I like to see what's out there. It's fun sometimes. I have my friend David Wolf has like an infomercial for some kind of blender thing he has on there. And I'm like, what? Guys love David's in a commercial. So it's interesting where we've done some TV stuff to see and we critique things. Like, there's no way that we're happy. They told them to do that. And when you're savvy and you are, you're in an awareness, not just like a consumer, you see things differently. So that's important to talk about.
Also, one of the ways that I think those people get introduced to film is through the TV. It's possible to think about what you're seeing and
to get introduced to
produce something based on that.
To get introduced to what?
Now speak louder, please.
I think one of the ways that most people get introduced to film is by watching TV, and that it's possible to think about what you're seeing and then to produce something after that. So, like, there's a lot of different types of video on TV. And you can think about it artistically. Almost anything you see or do can be done artistically if that person likes it. That's all. I just like to mention that as much as I can.
Yeah, I know my son, so we unschooled, and he went berserk with television too right away as soon as he was allowed to do whatever he wanted. And we just took the approach of genuinely being curious, like, what do you like about this show? I'm not trying to talk down, like, what do you like about it? Who are the characters you like? Why do you like them? Is that... And just introducing those ideas into his head, and this kind of sounds manipulative, but it's not. He started to look at it that way and to break down TV shows more, and he'd start to say, oh, I was watching this, but it wasn't realistic, it didn't make sense, it didn't follow. And now he has a different relationship to it, and we watch movies as a family, and he can break down different ideas in the movie, and so there's a lot of value, just as he was saying, with all these things. It's just how you look at it, you know?
Being a facilitator.
But it's getting him to think about it in that way, like, why do I like this?
Right.
Kind of helps avoid the
just
staring at the TV. Absolutely. You know, what is happening? What? Yeah.
What do you think that must be about staying conscientious if you are going to watch TV? That's how I learned it. Because, like, I've always thought of, like, entertainment. Like, I break words down, and, like, entertainment to me is like inner containment, basically. It's like inter your containment. You know, it's, like, it takes your mind away from elsewhere. You know, because if you're conscientious and thinking about it, you know, you can receive something from it and learn. If not, it's like, you know, it's like some people, they watch movies, but they don't even know what the movie is about after, and they're like asking, can you tell me what it's about?
Yeah, I think that's just being human. There's days where we all kind of get that, maybe it's on. I do want to say that I think an important thing to share is that although I say that I agreed with you, and I totally had the same feelings, I wouldn't force my children or impose those beliefs necessarily on them. Like, so there's a lot of times where you do have to grow as a person to find a win-win and peaceful situation when it comes to TV. You know, my kids came into play, I was petrified of it. I was definitely reading more anti-propaganda, and it was a very fearful, negative place that caused a lot of pain and distance. And on a lot of levels with me and my kids when we first started, Devin was like 2, you know, like. But then I started to see things through his eyes and started to understand the way what he was learning. I was seeing it. And then you just grow and you change and you become open-minded to seeing things from their perspective, which is very different oftentimes in a fear-based space. Fear is really damaging on a lot of levels, and it can be a self-fulfilling prophecy. I've read a lot of really interesting books and articles about the energy, like food, for example, that if you believe what your child's eating is junk, and they, you know, you're putting that energy on and they're eating it, and it is negatively affecting their body. Have you guys ever heard of the rice experiment?
The what experiment?
The rice experiment.
No.
Our family and I did it. I blogged about it. I couldn't believe what happened. We had 2 jars of cooked rice. You guys do this at home, seriously. On one jar we wrote, I love you. But on the other jar we wrote, I hate you, fool.
Wait, what?
Every day,
what?
I hate you, you fool.
I hate you, you fool.
Yes, on one jar of rice and the other jar of rice. Now, we learned this experiment through some different books we're reading. Other than the Emoto's water.
Yes.
It was based on that. So every single day, we would all, like, pick up one jar of rice and say, I love you, you're so beautiful. And we just put poor love on it. And the other one would say, I hate you, you fool. Well, in a month's time, the one that was painted molded was green. And the rice that we were saving, I'm as surprised as that gas. Because, and then so, and the white, the rice was perfect.
Wow.
It was a really powerful experiment that showed how you feel about things become reality. If you're seeing something as damaging, it probably will be.
Wow.
So much of this is like in the non-physical, stepping away from studies and really understanding that the energy of how you feel about what your kids are doing really has a lot to do with whether or not it's healthy or not. And to take responsibility for that. I know that sounds, might be a one level out there for you, but I'll tell you, it's amazing what you do. Yes.
How do you deal with when someone in the family is violating the needs of another person? How's the conflict resolution if we're not using fear and punishment?
What that never happens.
It never happens. I was gonna say, have teenagers.
No. The kids like don't get along half the time, and then get along half the time. So with children, it's really, especially when you're home. I think it's important to realize that human beings want to like learn problem solving, and when they're not part of this institutionalized education, by nature they're going to be like baby bear cubs, and just there's going to be moments where you have to help navigate things.
Right.
If the kids, now you're talking about the kids, like in general.
Well, you see everyone as an equal human being, right? We're all born perfect, whole, and complete. Mm-hmm. So if, yeah, let's say the, you know, someone's violating someone's rights, they're, you know, breaking their stuff or taking it or playing with their toys and not, you know, not sharing or, you know, being no fun. Mm-hmm. So.
Well, my kids are never forced to share. Just on that one.
Okay, no problem. Yeah, it's cool.
Their property is theirs and they're never forced to share ever. I totally believe I'm not in support of people when they force their kids to teach them sharing. In fact, I'll do the opposite. When fights break out or issues happen, the first thing I do is just say, what's going on? How can I help you guys? And sometimes they're fine on their own, but other times they need help. I try to be each other's voice, so I'll just be like, I'm just feeling, you know, really upset that you just took that or you threw that on the floor. Or I'll try to be the voice for those trying to communicate, but authentically. I think we can get stuck in this, like, an authentic script. Mm-hmm. And that just doesn't work for me. Like, I have to be myself and communicate to them. So I'll ask how I can help. Things usually dissipate on their own. But fighting and arguing are ways to find problem solving, and it looks different with children than adults. Like, I've learned skills that they are still learning. Devin is older, so it's amazing the skills that he has to be peaceful and patient. The girls, the sisters are the hardest ones energetically. And I think it's really hard when your kids don't like each other. That happens. The girls are go through moments where they just don't like each other. And it's hard not to internalize it and blame yourself. Like, oh my gosh, we live in this peaceful life. Everyone's supposed to be like holding hands and dancing around with butterflies flying around us. The reality is, it's peace. Living a peaceful life isn't always peaceful. I like to call it chaotic peace, because freedom is allowing them to learn the skills they need to, and have the freedom to not like each other.
Right.
So it doesn't necessarily look peaceful sometimes. Like, I know you guys know this, that peace doesn't always look like you think. Peace and respect and freedom can look messy. Yeah, while kids are learning, so.
Sí, bueno, nosotros también somos unschooler, pero no me decanto mucho por el radical unschooler porque yo sí que creo que es importante la relación con nuestros hijos, es más importante.
I'm going to remember it too much. We're also unschoolers, but not quite radical, because.
Sí, porque. Me cuesta mucho el tema de la comida, porque los niños antes de los 6, 7 años, pues, realmente no son muy conscientes.
So, the difference is regarding the food, because until they're 6 or 7 year old, the children are not really conscious.
Sí, no son conscientes de que si toquen, por ejemplo, el azúcar.
Sugar, for example.
Okay. Claramente, cuando mi hija de pequeña empecé a notar el efecto que le hace el azúcar en ella, le altera.
Which we noticed from a very early age, the effect that sugar had on her really alters her, changes her.
Ella es una niña de alta demanda y tiene mucha energía.
It's a very high demand, high energy child, so, yeah.
Y entonces me di cuenta que ella cuando detectaba que empezaba a bajar su energía, empezaba a pedir azúcar y pedía más.
So when she would detect that her energy levels would go down, she'd demand more sugar to keep it up. She really needed that sort of sugar high, I guess.
Entonces, nosotros somos orgánicos, somos todo de origen orgánico, y entonces yo empecé a tener un poco, a cuestionarme un poco si dejarle libre o tomar medidas.
Yeah, since we eat everything we can organic, so at that point, you know, we started to ask ourselves, should we let go, or should we, you know, put in place some measures to reduce that sort of risk of...
Yo encontré una cierta comodidad, o estoy más tranquila si dentro de, o sea, si hago un filtro y escojo yo la comida y le dejo elegir dentro de lo que yo he escogido previamente, para mantener un poco de orden o de...
Control.
Control.
Yeah, so she feels more comfortable, or she feels it's a better approach by having a selection of things to offer, but which within a realm of, you say, not that don't have a risk of damaging, she would say, so she can choose amongst that.
Yeah, perfect.
Yeah. It's okay.
You do the shopping. There is times in life where kids, some kids, you know, it depends on who they are as individuals, it'll be a struggle for parents in the grocery store. So I would recommend, you know, you do the shopping, bring home the food that you're comfortable with them eating, anything you bring. And then they have freedom within the home to pick and choose what they want. But based on, because there are kids with allergies that are too young to really understand, there are exceptions where, you know, taking your own part and saying, go at it, isn't possible. I do realize this. And so you doing the shopping, and I say you going alone to do the shopping, sometimes it's better than having to like limit or control the whole time you're there. So my husband, when the kids were really little, for one, I love to go by myself. Mm-hmm. I like to read labels and take hours in there. I'm really boring like that. Like, I'll just stay in the grocery store. it's like my night out.
So true.
Alone. But yeah, then you offer freedom.
Me too. Sometimes when she usually don't come with me, but the last time she come with me, and we are in a conventional smart supermarket, mm-hmm. and she goes to select something, industrial something, and I'm okay with that. I mean, I tell her, I'm okay, but don't hope to me, or don't expect to me that usually you, I mean, mm-hmm. because for me it's important, and I'm trying to be authentic with her, because I'm not a little freedom. Fear, because I know de que si ella come así y si empieza a comer y me pide más, sé que se va a alterar.
Yeah, well, she knows that if she keeps giving her, you know, she keeps demanding, she keeps giving it, she will definitely alter her.
Claro.
Her
so no me siento capaz de darle toda la libertad, pero sí lo que hago es darle un poco de libertad educándole.
So she doesn't feel therefore comfortable giving full freedom, but giving a certain amount of freedom whilst educating her in the process.
Yeah, okay. And as she gets older, she's going to understand. Like, my kids will, if they like something, we'll talk about like sweeteners that are healthy, like whether it's agave. I don't know if agave is popular here in the U.S. It's kind of a big, popular, like healthier sweetener. I know it's processed. Or maple syrup. You know, there's a lot of alternative sweeteners. So if my kids like something, I'll say, let's try to make that healthier. There's times where the trust between us is pretty intense sometimes with the kids. Like Ivy in particular, she'll say, is that healthy? She'll ask me always before she eats something, is that healthy? And I'll say, well, I don't know. And she's like, fine, I won't get it. I'm like, what do you mean? I said, it's okay in moderation. She'll say, you said it wasn't healthy. I said, well, I just was kind of like, I don't know. I mean, I think anything in moderation can be considered healthy if you want to try those, if you want some Starburst, you know, like to be like, no, that's so bad for you. Isn't reality. Like, I think our bodies can handle a lot. You know, our bodies take what they need, and we are very healthy, but so they really rely on, I mean, this trust they have in me is a big responsibility. I have to remember that when I say something, they're going to take it, so then she'll get frustrated, like, no, I'm not going to get it, you said it wasn't healthy. Well, sweetie, you can have a couple, as long as you don't eat like 20 packs of those, it's going to be fun. We have to enjoy life. It's fun to have things that we normally wouldn't. Like, while we're here, I'm sure I'll try some things that aren't like totally healthy, just to experience the culture, experience life somewhere else. So I really have to be conscious of how I word things. Because if I say no, it's not healthy, they really take it to heart and internalize it. So you're faced with really asking yourself, is this true? You know, when your kids trust you and believe you, it's your responsibility to really, you learn a level of honesty and authenticity that you never lived before. Because they believe you, they trust you, they look up to you. So I'll say, is it healthy? That's like a really big question. Is artificial colors or sugar? But is it healthy? Well, I believe your body's really healthy and can handle a bad experience. You know, if that's what you want to experience, and try it. So being positive and honest is everything, because if not, it can really be stressful for our kids to battle with their inner desires versus what you're, you know, the information you're giving them. So it is a new responsibility when you're living this type of life.
It's really interesting. It's like realizing the responsibilities that we have when we do things, you know, in a trusted environment.
Yeah.
There isn't much trust. The awareness of our responsibility just goes down.
Right.
Very
true.
But we are.
Extremely.
I was going to make a quick point, but we are living in a time where food is no longer what it was, as we all know, and it's getting worse. And this is just an impossible question or quandary for us all, because how bad is that food? You know, although I believe, well, we also follow that view, especially here about this, that your mind sort of affect your emotions, you know, what is it you're eating? But there's a point where I think it's junk, it's just you can't make it. It's not like wine into water, water into wine, you know, it doesn't quite go that far. But
you can just do the shopping, right?
Yeah,
the point is, like, kids understand this. Like, so you're, I know the point that you're at with your kids. I'm sorry, can you, do you want to finish what you're saying?
No, we're
all talking about, we're excited, we're talking over each other.
That's fine,
not
I finished, I said it.
When you have this type of relationship, and you, when I say my kids take a cart, I think it's important to say that the choices that they make would probably surprise you. Last time we did that, Ivy took a bag of oranges, and she loves Brussels sprouts. And she got some pasta and some white pasta sauce she likes. There are things that you'd be, that most people would be approve of. It's not like they took bags of chips and donuts and whipped them in the car and I was like, okay, find your own moderation. They truly, you have to model this for your kids. So it's not do as I say, not as I do. It's really important that you get behind your beliefs and you model it. And then if they do want something special, like Ivy loves popsicles. So we talk about, she gets juice pops now. Instead of like the color, you know, we find ways to help meet their needs healthy, and they want to be healthy. What human wouldn't want to do what was good for themselves unless they were controlled their whole lives?
Yes.
We make the assumptions about children that aren't reality. We make assumptions that they want to make bad choices, that they're going to overindulge, that they're going to like eat things that are really bad for them. It's amazing to me that how untrue that is when kids really live freedom, you know, because they want it to be good. They want to be good people. They want to do good for their bodies. And I never knew what that was until I was pregnant. I didn't care what I did to my, you know, I ate so much bad stuff.
So for me, it's important to communicate to her the mi necesidad de cuidarle.
Her needs to care for her. As mothers need to care for her daughter.
So, y creo que ahí entonces no siente ella la prohibición, sino que entiende la necesidad.
So the daughter does not feel the force of the prohibition, but feels her need to care for her.
Y pienso que es mucho más respetuoso que decirle no comas esto o no.
She feels it's more respectful instead of saying don't eat this, you know.
Hablar
I have to care for you.
Hablar desde qué me pasa a mí.
Her needs, yeah. So she tells her what her needs are, and then the daughter understands. It's true, our daughter does understand that now much.
We can even just be honest and say, you know what, I know the spirit, I mean, in the level that she's going to understand. There's times I've said, I know the spirit seems ridiculous, and I'm sorry. I'm just like, probably my own past conditioning. My kids have heard me say that so many times. I know it's my past conditioning, but I'm just really feeling glitchy about this situation. Talk me through it. Let's talk about this. Like, why do you want to do this? And like, when you throw your fear on the table and you don't let it guide how you're interacting, you just let them know, I'm afraid, I don't know why, it's probably stupid, but I just am, let's talk about it. Kids are really empathetic. Like, my kids get it, you know? My son's like, I know Evie screwed you up, my mother, she may have been really weird about this, but the reality is this, or, and I say, she did the best she could, she didn't screw you too good.
So that really goes against the idea that parents should always be certain and never show any insecurity or
fear. Right. Oh, I love that you just said that, because we're told from the beginning of when we bring children into this world that we can't show signs of weakness because they'll manipulate us. And that's an overall, like, you can't show them your fears, you can't show them
anxious.
But that's an authoritarian paradigm dynamic. I mean, leaders are told that. You know, like, that's not healthy, that's not partnership. Like, there's times where I tell my kids, yesterday, where were Ivy and I? I had a little minor panic attack. Somewhere in this trip, I can't remember. But we were in the bathroom and I couldn't find something. She's like, Mom, I'm gonna just breathe. I've got this. You know, when you support your kids, I authentically let them see if I get panicky. Devin's always the best to get me out. stressful when you have kids because you want to make sure you have everything. Any nightmares I have are always about losing things, or I didn't remember to bring this or that, like for some reason. So my kids are always reassuring me, and you, when you lay your fears on the table, honestly, you lay them on the table to dissipate the guilt, and your kids help you do that as much as you help them. So a partnership parenting paradigm is very different from the authoritarian parenting paradigm, because you're all helping each other on this path of growth and parenting, and they learn that when you love somebody, you facilitate their learning. You do. It's just part of partnership. And my friends, if I know that they love something, I'll facilitate their learning. I'll get them a magazine subscription or get them a book. My husband showed interest in, he was watching this show, like Orange County Chopper or something. Really boring motorcycle show. But he loved it. I bought him a magazine subscription and a book about it. And
it's interesting.
Yeah, he hasn't really watched anymore, but he used to like it. He thought it was kind of cool. So when you love each other, you nurture each other's learning and interests. So my kids do that with me. That becomes part of just what partnership is. And so learning is part of being part of the community and helping each other. You know, the more you get to know somebody, the more excited I get to help my kids to their learning and learn what it's about. And so a partnership-based paradigm is really different. My kids, we're in this together. It doesn't mean that I don't acknowledge that there are things that are developmentally challenging for them to understand, and we meet them where they're at. We can do those kind of things when they're really little.
I wanted to share my experience with my daughter. She likes candy and chocolate. And on two occasions, she's overindulged and has said, I've eaten too much sugar. I feel sick. And does she still eat it? She does now, but she's a self-modification. So she has a piece of candy and, you know, I remind her, you felt sick last time. And with regard to like bedtimes or anything, it's funny, they don't have a bedtime, but they are in bed by 9. Self-imposed, I am tired, I want to go to bed. And that's awesome. My bedtime was 9 when I was a kid, and I tried to stay up as long as I could, because I thought there was a party going on, and I wasn't allowed to go, you know? But yeah, the trust that we have as a family has allowed them to have their own self experiment where they learn it all, and they have the security to bounce off what they're experiencing with my experience with eating too much sugar, staying up too late, and that's awesome. Like I wouldn't trade it for anything. It's been fantastic. But you know, my son, he eats really healthy food, quinoa and tomatoes, and I mean avocado, and he's 3. And my daughter eats hot dogs and mac and cheese. So you know, it's just what they do. It is what it is.
I have another thing to say about the sugar. I read a long time ago that experiments were done with kids with placebos and sugar. And the kids were told it was sugar. There's different variations on it. But in general, the scientists found that there's no physical sugar high. It's only it's only a psychological thing that was usually times to it being seen differently or it being restricted or something like that, and that the sugar high as a physical thing didn't actually exist.
That's amazing you say that, because I was going to pull into the whole idea that you will see what you want to see. Mm-hmm. And some people try to control their kids with food, and what I mean by that is they try to control their behavior by not allowing them to eat certain things. That is not the same as choosing a healthy diet. So I think control comes in sneaky ways. You know, if you're trying to control your kid not to get hyper because it's inconvenient for you, so you keep sugar from them to control them into this compliance, it's pretty humbling to like swallow that and realize that you're doing that. You know, like it's an important to realize that you're doing that. But, oh, I didn't realize it. And being honest and talking to somebody about it, you don't have to be embarrassed about it. My friends that have been walking this path of this type of parenting, there's times we call each other out and we ask each other to. Some friends have glitches with food. Some people have issues with other things, and we're supposed to support and help each other because conditioning goes deep. And what I was saying before about the food, about this being a self-fulfilled prophecy, that if you see sugar as being the reason for negative behavior, that is what you're going to see. Like if your child eats sugar, you're in a fearful state of, oh gosh, now they're going to act weird. And then anything they do, you're like, there it is. You will see exactly what you want to see because your fear is directing you in that direction. And I've seen it time and time again with parents. So I'm not saying that sugar is good for you. I'm not saying I'm invalidating that reality. But there are times where you really have to realize, is this really happening? Or am I like seeing this based on my fear and really dissecting that? When my kids like something that's sweet, we'll find something. Like if your child likes a certain cookie brand, you can get excited. So let's go try to make that with something healthier so they're like, good for us and just as yummy. And we made homemade Oreos that were vegan. Well, Oreos are vegan anyway, but with like a vegan raw version that were made with everything really good. They were made with cashew cream. And like the kids get excited when they something tastes really good and it's good for them. So yeah, I just want to point that out. So I love that you said that. I like what you're sharing. Somebody ran their hand raised too.
There are different types of sugar, right? And that's, I feel like candy, like Halloween candy, like me, like when I have kids in the future, like I wouldn't give them like candy, like for candy to me, it's like fruits, because it's natural sugar. Because the candy, like, in the candy today, it's acidic, it destroys the teeth, and it's concentrated too. It's like the hash oil, you know, because I'm into candy for my health reasons, but hash oil is concentrated, it's actually dangerous. But the flower itself, it's healing.
That's a good point.
It's a holistic, you know?
Totally. And the question that it's easy before you have kids, I think, and I love your intention. However, if you were faced with a power struggle of then saying, Daddy, I really want this, that changes everything if you say, no, you're not allowed. So that's what we're faced with, like, is imposing force or control over human beings that have different desires and needs and wishes than we do. How do you find the win-win? How do you find the compromise in those situations in a peaceful, loving way? So I hear you, totally, and I love your intention.
It turns into alcohol, though, in the stomach. Like the sugar turns into alcohol, just like starch turns into alcohol, too. So that's why, you know, they're hyper, they're drunk.
Yeah, I mean, I've never heard that, but I'm totally interested in researching and learning everything I can about these kind of topics. So. It can be really scary, for sure. Yeah. Halloween is so fun for my kids. They're getting older, so they're not so much into it, but trick-or-treating and collecting all that candy, when kids have total freedom, they sit and they trade what they like. It sits under their bed in a bag for like till Valentine's Day, a lot of it, you know, and then, like, do you guys really want this? It's like stuck together. The actual act of trick-or-treating, for example, a lot of people are fearful of candy, but the act is fun to go out and get stuff like that, and so you have to take the whole thing into consideration. The kids are pretty picky with what candy they like. Devin's just like, we're just taking our cups, it's pretty much it.
This past year, my brother came with his daughter, who is allergic to nuts, chocolate, soy, and I went to my neighbors and got these little toys from the dollar store and gave them all a toy to give her when she appeared at their door to trick-or-treat. So she had never experienced trick-or-treating. And she came up and she went to the door, and to get candy, she got Slinkies, a pencil, fake lipstick, and all my kids are like, we don't want candy, we want toys. So this year, now we're gonna go to the dollar store and do toys, and just give them to all the kids and all the neighbors, and you know, maybe you can get away from candy. Do toys, cards and stuff. So
you can just ship it. So we're going to take a break in just a minute here, but I just want to touch on one thing about something that's related to that. Junk food and junk toys are an issue that people have, and especially coming from like a Waldorf background or Montessori, a lot of times people do label like McDonald's toys, junk toys, and those kind of things. I'm living this life to give my kids as big of a world possible to learn and grow from, not limit them, not control them into a smaller little space that I feel is righteous or holistic or whatever. I like that they can choose from like the full range of human potential and everything. And sometimes getting a junk toy is fine. And I don't call it that, by the way. I'm just for clarity. We're junk food, junk toys. My kids can choose from the whole buffet of life. And you know what? We collected the McDonald's toys, which was a stretch for me at first, but they really loved it. So the work side of making a show is a lot, but it's really fun. Really, like, how many can you just do that? It was just like, you feel like get your little 15 minutes to feel really, like, what it feels like to be,
Did you were not forced to act in a certain way.
No. They'd have me repeat things. They'd have us redo scenes if they didn't get an angle, which was kind of challenging. because it's a little inauthentic when you're doing it again. You know, the first time's really authentic, and you just did it, but then like, oh, can we miss that? Can we do that again? And you're like, it just doesn't feel the same to like do it over, but you did what I did.
It sounds so weird. Like you have an interaction with someone, and then they ask you to do it again.
Yeah.
Can't even imagine.
Wish I could do that, but I'm like, so let me tell you again.
It is kind of good, so you can fine tune if you did like what you said, but then you don't know which one they're going to show, and so it takes a lot of trust in your advocacy and principles to do it, and then just say whatever happens is going to happen. You can't be attached to the outcome. And that was the hardest thing, is to not be attached to the outcome of any of these. You're completely not in control of any of it. And they can spin it any way they want, they can make you look. So I could have came out looking like I did on Nightline, which the Nightline episode came out really different than it was. And that's just the risk you take, but you keep saying yes, and it's helping, so.
But now when you go out and you're in the area,
sometimes. Yeah, airports a lot. And it's only when I wear the white headband. Only when I wear the white headband. Like, I don't wear it all the time, but people recognize me with that. Well, no, some people have actually a couple other times, but it's not like crazy. Well, the weird thing is like more people don't say anything to you, but you see them whispering. But it triggers that school stuff so bad. When you see people whispering, you're like, oh, that weird time. Like, you don't know. You're triggered in all your insecurities. You see them whispering and pointing. I saw somebody like doing a selfie, like far. I'm like, just say hi. Like, I'm happy to talk to you. Just come over and say hi. But it's kind of strange feeling when they don't communicate with you, but yet they're taking photos and stuff. It's
can I take a picture then? Or like,
yeah, sure.
I'll
take one with you if you want.
I would love one with you.
Okay, well, we have all of you.
Okay, I'll do anything like that.
Yeah?
No. We'll
do one later. But I love that people. Yeah. Not that they would recognize me, but they'd recognize the philosophy, you know, philosophically, when they see me, they're like, oh, what is she talking about? Unschooling, like, I love that. It could just represent that whole perspective. All right, guys, so I think everyone's back, I think. So we can just get started.
Are we doing this one?
Yeah, I mean, I'm happy to, this is for you. You guys are here. I'm here to give you information about any aspect that you'd like to know more about. This is a really in-depth philosophy. We can talk more about parenting, peaceful parenting, or we can talk more about unschooling, that aspect of it.
A bit of a generic question, which you could apply to anarchism or peaceful parenting. Do you find it more useful or effective to approach really bad parents and change them, like, so you can improve, like, change a really bad parent into a mediocre one? Or you are looking for the mediocre or like kind of good parents all turning into really good ones. What's more effective?
Well, I don't approach anybody unless they want what I have to say. So I don't advocate to people this particular philosophy unless they're looking for it. And the reason being is I know how learning works. They have to be internally motivated to know what I have to say. I will not force learning on anyone. To me, it's controlling for me to try to control it. It's doing something different. So I'm very open, and the one thing I will do though, say if I see, well, let me just tell you a little story. I wrote this article called Love It Forward about being on a plane in England on the way back from the first ever London unschooling conference. And there was this woman in front of me, I had my kids with me, and she had a baby that was just standing at a two-year-old. They were sitting in front of me and the baby was like standing facing me looking over the seat, and the mother was pinching its legs, telling it, get down, and kind of like swatting at her two-year-old, very angry and upset, and I could see the kids being mistreated. I whispered to my husband and I said, oh my gosh, can you look at this mother? I said, how are we gonna sit here? Like, I'm not gonna be able to take somebody this mean to their kids. There's no way.
You're not gonna what? I can't.
I'm not gonna take somebody being this mean to their kids. Like, I can't sit here and witness abuse. Like, it's not gonna happen. And then we talked for a while, and something inside me, I don't know what happened, but kind of like I talked to you about the white swan thing, something shifted. Where I said, I think I'm going to be more useful if I could offer help. So I leaned over the seat and I said, can I come sit near you? And she was like, I guess so. And so I switched places with one of my children and she sat behind me. And I sat there and I just said, can I help you at all? Like with your kids? Can I give you a hand? And she looked at me and she just broke down and started sobbing. And she said, I just got back from it. This is my third day traveling back from Asia. I haven't slept in 2 days. I haven't seen my husband in 3 months. I'm alone and I'm exhausted. And there was a moment within me that said, I was judging this mother for who she was, and she was desperate. She said it, she looked me in the eyes and said, she didn't know who I was or what I did or anything, and she said, I'm not normally like this. I hate being like this to my kids. I'm just so tired, I don't know what to do, and I can't help them. And I said, let me help you. And so for the rest, I said, take a nap. We've got them, I'll take care of them. And so I took her kids, I walked up and down the aisle with a 2-year-old, I held the baby, and I got her a cup of tea. She drank it and she slept for like the whole 6 hours and woke up. When she woke up, she looked at her kids and gave them a hug, and like she was so loving and sweet. And it was in that moment that I realized that so many times we judge other people for being, especially those of us that are passionate about peace. Like, we judge them for being punitive or authoritarian, and we don't know if that's who their true being is or if they're having a rough moment. So always meet people with love and understanding and non-judgment, and offer help, because that's the only thing that's going to change the world. I could have sat there in judgment, criticizing her. For one, it would have hurt her so much. She would have been worse to her kids. Those kids would have suffered if I was judgmental. Those kids would have suffered that whole flight. Instead, opening my heart to love and understanding and learning that this wasn't who that mother was. I mean, we've all been in that desperate space as parents or witnessed it, where you just are empty. You can't operate from a place of conscious parenting because you're in primitive mode, and this mother was basically swatting and grunting because she couldn't do anything else, you know? From that moment on, I changed inside. In the beginning of my journey with natural birth advocacy, I really internally judged people that chose a scheduled C-section or dedicated birth. It was controlling, it was judgmental, but it was my process. And I think we all have to go through that, you know? When I became a breastfeeding advocate, if I saw a baby with formula, my heart would just bleed, you know? I'd be like, oh, that poor baby deserves mother's milk. And I still truly believe that. However, I'm not in that person's shoes, and I don't know their story. The way that we change the world toward more peace, freedom, is modeling the philosophy in every area of our life, not just parenting. You shouldn't have a double standard with your kids versus how you interact with other people. My kids learned so much that day when they're playing. We've talked about it since, and actually out of any article I ever wrote, that got the most views and shares, and I wasn't expecting it to at all. Like, because it was just kind of like, hey, here's my story. It wasn't like about unschooling. It was about not judging other people and how to judge the philosophy further and further in ever-widening circles. So I've shared with you about the peaceful parenting, focusing on people, the kids' needs, and the behavior. So I ask you to not only internalize that, but take that one step further. And when you see somebody in public, don't focus on their behavior, focus on their needs. And how can you help this fellow human have their needs met? And that is what brings more peace into the world. Not by judging people because they're not peaceful like you, or they're not in a higher consciousness, or they're not anarchist, or whatever you find to be the ultimate way. The only way to show people what that way is to be it, not to control people into it, not to preach it, not to criticize it, not to judge. Because this, that truly is the epitome of the philosophy, is to just be that. And since then, I've helped, it's hard. There are times where I see children being mistreated, but I will go over and help, or I'll ask. For example, we were in one store, Claire's, and this family was in. Their little girl was probably 3, and she was crying because they wanted to get her ears pierced. I was drawn to the situation, and so I'm kind of like lingering, looking at necklaces, and I'm like, come on, I'm like, well, I'm just struggling, this little girl's crying, and I'm going to force her to pierce her ears. So I was trying to figure out in my head, how can I approach this? I wanted to go over and save that little girl. So I eventually got courage enough to approach them, and I said, excuse me. And they said, yes. I said, are you open to hearing a different perspective?
Mm-mm.
And which really works, because I'm asking if they want to be invited, instead of saying, you know, you shouldn't do that. You know, why are you doing that? You shouldn't hurt your child or whatever. I just said, are you open to hearing my perspective on this? And they were like, yes, sure. I mean, I think the father was like, yeah, sure. Because he seemed like he was the one that didn't really want to, but the mother was like, really had her mindset. She's like, okay. And I said, would you be open to maybe, you know, understanding that it should be her choice if you do? I mean, totally believe whatever you need to do. I respect you, but I'm just saying, when my daughters chose to get their ears pierced, it was very empowering, and it was a rite of passage, and it was beautiful. We actually got them, we went out to dinner, we recorded it. It was so special when they got their ears pierced because they chose to do it. And they like were silent, and they ended up like walking out and not doing it. And so sometimes you have to be kind and loving, and I'm not saying not to speak up, but when you do, really ask if it's okay to give your advice. So if you're in a situation where you want to just scream, just say, can I help you? Do you need help? Or are you open to hearing my perspective? Can I share another thought with you? And if they say yes, then you got the green light to say, here's my perspective. could have came right back in and got it done after I left. I don't know where they are waiting still, but at least I spoke my truth.
Hi. Hi, my name is Howard Lickman, and I couldn't make the first part of it, so I wanted to talk to you later on to kind of contract for me asking you a couple of questions, etc. But so I have two children, two boys, 11 and 12, and I've been using, I used the paddle until probably about 6 months ago, where listening to 7 Mile New kind of got me into, you know, maybe I should do that. And I only paddled my kids 3 times in like their entire life, and I felt bad about it, you know, each and every time. But so now they kind of are at the transition where they realize, well, Dad's not using the paddle anymore, so now I have to negotiate. And so I just, you know, what's your thoughts on when you're running up against, you know, 11 and 12 year olds and they won't comply, and I'm, you know, coming off of using, while I haven't used the paddle, I was a big fan of pain compliance, grabbing them by the, you know, the shoulder and just giving them a little twitch to make sure that they do what they're supposed to do. And so now I'm looking for alternative strategies to gain their compliance. So I apologize if y'all have already covered this. So.
No, that's great. Well, I'm glad you're here. One thing is, how do I get them to comply? I don't. That's not a goal for me. I don't try to get my kids to comply with my needs, but I do want them to... their needs are just as important as my needs. So, rather than compliance, I'm looking for situations where everybody's needs are met. So traditional parenting is more focused on obedience and compliance and behavior modification, which is what most people do, what you're sharing. And thank you for your honesty in sharing that in this forum, because I think honesty and authenticity is important in sharing our what we've done in the past and so forth. A partnership-based parenting paradigm, or peaceful parenting, what we're talking about here, is focused on meeting the needs of everybody in the family. Not just the adult's needs for compliance, uninterrupted sleep, obedience. This is very different. A lot of modern like parenting techniques are really similar to dog training because of this like behavior modification. And it's been compared to that because it's only meeting the needs of a parent. So if we're in this world to model for our children how to be in this world, when you're living in that paradigm of behavior modification or looking for compliance, children then grow up to be adults thinking that's what you do. You force other people through pain. Force to do what you want, as opposed to living in a more world peace view of focusing on the fact that everybody's needs matter. And this isn't something that you can tell a child, it's something that you have to live. So because my kids know that everybody's needs matter, that's how they approach life, that's how they approach other situations. They know that it takes time to find solutions, to focus on everybody's needs. So in that particular situation, what were your needs? What's like the last time you could think of the paddling situation? What was the issue? Do you remember?
I don't remember specifically, but you know, getting a 12-year-old or an 11-year-old to do something that they don't want to do is the issue.
And I mean, I'm sure you've heard this. You're at this event, so I'm sure you've heard Stefan in different philosophical perspectives. But what if you did that to your partner, your wife? Like with that, you know, it's kind of, when you hear it from that perspective, I think it's important to understand that it wasn't very long ago that men were told to feed their wives when dinner wasn't on the table all the time. Historically, that was the job of husbandry, to train up your wife to obey you and serve. Fathers told their husbands how to do it, all the different ways to do it. Doctors even recommended that men did it for the good of their wives, and that's what wives knew their role to be. Well, look at how far we've come in most cultures. Men would be arrested, it's abuse, and so forth. So it's really just a human evolution perspective that right now the same thing is happening with children. The evolution of children's rights is on the cusp of shifting. This is a real kind of pioneering thing to get out there and stand up for children's rights. And people only do what they know how to do. So the fact that you parented like that, it's just what's done. You know, there's no blame, it's just when you know a different perspective, I think you need to know why that's not okay. If somebody did that to you, they'd be, you know, arrested or whatever, depending upon where they are. It wouldn't be okay for someone to force you to do what they wanted or to comply. And it wouldn't be okay to do to your partner, and this is saying, this philosophy, that it's not okay to do to children. So, but it is kind of confusing because people think if you're not controlling or punishing or forcing somebody to obey, that the other option must be completely hands-off permissive. That's all we've been taught. We were taught that anything but controlling isn't love. We'll say you don't love your children unless you're controlling them and, you know, training them up and those kind of things. Because all we've really ever known is permissiveness or hands-off or non-love. However, this is completely different. This is a very hands-on philosophy. It takes work. One thing I said prior when you weren't here is that rules are replaced by forbidden there, that when you're present, you don't need them. You operate from a place of principles. We live by principles in our house, not rules. And it's just completely unnecessary when you're focused on your kids' needs. So in that moment, you know, I would ask you if you were more, if it was more current to do memory, like, what was he doing? Was he in the middle of doing something and he didn't want to stop? I mean,
so like one comes to mind, it's not a big deal, but you know, so we don't watch television or have screens or, you know, screen time. So we play a lot of games in the house. And my youngest wanted to, you know, just do his own thing, but we needed him because there was a three-person game, so we wanted him to do it. And so it wasn't an issue where I would actually spank him or anything like that, but it's just, you know, like, it's just that, and I know this seems like not important, but I mean, it's like a little thing. Where Jackson, why don't you just come and play with the family, and you know, because we need you, and it's just, it turns into an issue, and you can't really, and he likes the game, but he just, for whatever reason, didn't want to do it, and I feel like that's a bad example, but that's
no,
my...
I mean, any example is great, important. We need to go by these real-life examples to see what to do instead. I love when people give me real-life examples. In that situation, if it was coming from like a peaceful parenting perspective, if one person didn't want to play, they wouldn't have to play, and then we would just say, well, we still want to play a game, what could we all play together that three people could play together, instead of forcing somebody else? Because in truth, I guarantee that game was not fun. There's no way somebody could be forced to do something and have it be fun for anyone. That negative energy and resentment is present the whole time, which leaves disconnect. Possibly that child would not want to play that game for a long time again. And it leaves that feeling about the whole interaction and time for like family game night with that negative energy, and it doesn't need to feel like that. So it's just respecting their space and saying, well, would you, when's a good time for you? Would you like to play with us? And then if he says, well, yeah, but I'm in the middle of something, can we do it like an hour? And then you say, well, I want to take a shower by an hour. How about half an hour? You guys, like, you want to finish what you're doing, we can play, and then I'll take a shower. Okay, you know, negotiation, talking, finding win-win situations, and then meeting everybody respectfully with their needs. So, I mean, I would be resentful, too, if somebody was mad at me or forced me or got upset with me if I'm not playing the game if I didn't want to. I see where you're coming from completely. You wanted to be able to play the game, but you have to be more flexible, I think, on this path to say, his needs matter just as much as everybody else's right now. He doesn't want to play. So how fun is it going to be for him?
I have a real life example.
Okay.
Because, you know, it's funny, you know, just as I'm listening to everyone, all of my questions are being answered, so it's awesome. But, you know, like for instance, my 16-year-old daughter, she has braces, and she wanted braces. So, you know, that was something that I told all the kids, you know, if you want to have braces, that's fine. If not, you know, it's your choice. My daughter, who's 18 now, she waited, and so she's still in braces, she's 18. But my 16-year-old as well chose to get braces on, and now we're having the struggle about, you know, whether she's gonna brush her teeth or not. So the last couple times she's gone to get her braces adjusted, you know, the dentist or the orthodontist is looking at me, you know, like, well, she's not brushing her teeth good enough. And you know what I mean? It's like our whole society puts that pressure on the parent of taking responsibility for something. And I've told her this. We've had all kinds of conversations like, well, you know, do you want to get your braces off now? I mean, your teeth aren't really done according to the orthodontist. But I can't take responsibility for you not brushing your teeth properly. I can't be standing over you all the time. This was your choice. So how do you work through things like that? You know, where your child has made a choice, and I know this is just an example of braces, but it could be anything. They've chosen something, but now they're kind of, or in maybe even you are suffering the consequences of them not following through with that choice. Does that make sense?
Yeah, if you mean suffering through the consequences because the dentist was kind of upset with you or thinking it was you, is that what you mean?
Yeah, or even her too. I mean, they were kind of, you know, well, then you're not doing this properly. And you know what I mean? Just kind of that whole guilt trip.
Well, we've talked to our kids about that before we go to the pediatrist. They know that teeth is their passion, man. and it's important for them to be, you know, so they know that the dentist, that's their thing. That's really important. Just like when you go to the hair salon, oh my gosh, you just need this $28 conditioner. You know, everyone has their passion. So there's been many times with the dentist, they've spoken to us, but I just shared our philosophy with the kid's dentist, and now she knows it. And I just say, well, I don't believe in forcing. I mean, we're by their side. And I asked her, are there any options that we could do for them on a night that they may not want to brush? Because, you know, they don't always want to. I mean, now they're older, they do, but when they were younger. And she's like, wow, no one's ever asked that before. Actually, if you swish some water in your mouth, that really does loosen up a lot of stuff. Or if you take a washcloth and wipe their teeth. And so we started brainstorming, pulling her in the partnership dynamic of ways that the kids could get their teeth clean on a night that they may not want to brush. And they did it. They had a choice. They talked about it. I think as far as the braces go, it really has to be an internal space and letting her know that, you know, it's really important to your teeth. But what was the dentist saying? Like, what was the result of that?
You know, you're going to get gingivitis, kind of the whole fear thing, you know, you're going to get gingivitis, your daughter's going to get gingivitis if she doesn't brush her teeth properly.
You don't need to enforce any of that.
Yeah.
Just so you know, I think it's really a matter of us unconditioning ourselves to look at these people as authorities in our life, that we're kind of afraid of a reaction. And just
right.
So that's kind of within you to just,
yeah.
You know, we've heard stuff like that. And they told us that the kids had to have teeth removed for new teeth to grow in, and we talked about it. And so I appreciate very much you suggesting that, but we're fine with just letting them fall out on the ground. Because they're really big on removing certain teeth now, so other teeth can grow in, which. So we talk about it, just be open and honest, and just appreciate it. And they know us now. I don't know what they're thinking when we come in. Actually, they're like, Martin's our hero. You know, they saw us on voice swap and all that stuff, so they watched it as a, yeah, so they know that we're a little different, but I think that they can appreciate our perspective. And they, I'm a good consumer. I hired that dentist to work for me. That's how it goes down. I tell her how it is. She meets me in partnership with, she wants me as a patient, my four kids as a patient. And to work within my philosophy, she's a part in a partnership when she decides to have us as a patient. So it is different, but that she understands, and I hired her, not the other way around.
Can I say something?
Yep.
Like a lot of times when parents give advice to their children, the children don't listen. I feel like it's because the children don't trust their parents because they've been told so often, like, you should do this because this is better for you. But in reality, those advices were just for the parents. Like, you should study this, you should get your degree because it's better for you. But in reality, it's just because the parents will feel better if you have a degree. So kids feel often like, oh man, it's not about me, it's just about you, so why should I listen to your advice?
Well, it's about the parents' ego, right? It's destroying their ego. Oh, my kid went to Harvard, got this degree, look at me. Whereas the kid's just miserable and had no choice in that.
Exactly, yeah, that's a good point. It's important to realize that, you know, when things go really well, we like to take the credit as if it was our doing, but I've even learned to just let them own that. So when the dentist says, you've done a great job telling Tiffany to brush her teeth, she has no cavities, I'm like, it's her, not tell her that. Because just like I don't force them, I don't want to take the pride when it was my daughter's choice to shift gears. And I think with teeth, it's really interesting. It's a big deal. Teeth are hard. I do not believe in putting my knee on my kid's chest while I force them to brush their teeth. The damage emotionally that comes from that is way worse than any cavity that could be filled or removed. So I think sometimes you're faced with a decision, and I've done this many times, of really thinking it out, like, which is worse? The force of the decision, is it really that big of a deal with your first teeth? I mean, I know that teeth brushing is important. I'm sure there's some passionate teeth people out here that are like, but to me, my relationship comes before, my good relationship with my child comes before teeth, because teeth can be fixed. Our relationship may not be.
Real quick, my granddaughter wasn't brushing her teeth, and she lied to my son and my daughter-in-law. And what my son did was put her, she's 5 years old, sat her on his lap, went through the internet, and showed her a bunch of women that took meth and had really shitty teeth, and it scared the crap out of her. And I didn't, I had an ethical dilemma about that, you know, whether that would was the most appropriate thing. But I'll tell you what, she, to this day, this was about 3 years ago, she takes a lot of pride in her teeth brushing. So, I don't know, what did you think about that? He wasn't mean. He just gave her. These are the facts. I mean, if you don't brush your teeth, it could.
It's a lie.
Well,
it's meth.
He used the extreme. But if you don't brush your teeth, you can get cavities and you can lose teeth and stuff like that. So.
He should have just shown cavities.
Another thing specific to teeth. If a child is brushing their teeth with a fluoride toothpaste, maybe they don't like brushing their teeth because it's actually making them sick. And they're in tune with their bodies and they can sense that.
I love that point. I never heard a point like that, but you're right. No, we don't use fluoride in toothpaste, but that's true, right? Because kids are very instinctual and they can tune into that kind of thing.
Ants, like you put fluoride or aspartame in this stuff and feed it to ants, they won't go near the stuff. If our children, they're actually in tune with their bodies, they wouldn't do it either.
My son has his two front teeth taken out because he didn't brush his teeth. And they were actually causing him enough pain that they took them out. And that was, I hated that day. But to this day now, he has a completely truthful based experience of what can happen when you don't brush your teeth. Whereas I did what I thought was the best. So I didn't want to hold him down and brush his teeth because then he's going to be afraid of brushing his teeth and hate me. So now we're just waiting for his adult teeth to come in, but he's got two front teeth on, and he's been sleeping through the night, and he's happier, and he's learned a lesson, too. So
I just wanted to address what you shared about using fear. When you say it worked, it may have worked to get her to comply. Yes, that is the fact it did. However, I know what fear does to people on the inside. And the negative side effects that would come from just living with that kind of fear within your body is way more physically damaging than any condition your teeth could get into. So just because you can't see it does not mean it worked. It worked for her, that mother, to have her needs met, but for clients, and I know people get desperate. If there's no other options or tools, you do what you gotta do, and it works, and I'm sure she feels very good about that. However, because it did work for obedience, now that's the tool in this child's life. Wow, this kind of fear worked, and that's... That's not the best thing for the child. It was the most convenient for the adult, but it was not the best for the child.
Right.
And so it was kind of a narcissistic way to go about it. But again, I think that our parenting paradigm is very narcissistic. And then we go through life, you know, hearing in the media from other people like, how did our society become so narcissistic? Nobody's seeing what's in front of their face. They're saying it must be all those permissive parents or not controlling it. In fact, it's literally control that is causing narcissism. And it's
good point. I did have an ethical dilemma. I did not approve of that. But, you know, I thank you for validating my issue.
I have a comment on teeth. I don't know, I have a lot of thoughts on teeth, but one thing I would like to mention is that there's a kind of resin that can be painted on any age person's teeth. And the resin is normally put on the back molars, but also the middle molars, and can be on the bicuspids, and it prevents cavities from being possible to form.
We do that in the Netherlands. Everyone does it.
In the Netherlands, people do it, but a lot of doctors in the U.S. Don't advertise it. They do a lot more fillings, which are, it kind of fixes the problem after it's already happened, versus it's called a resin that can be painted on. It makes it so you cannot get cavities.
I heard about
on,
that.
On the
yeah.
surface, on the top surface of the teeth.
Yeah.
Just where they normally form.
I think the next group is going to be in here, but I want to ask one final question, take a high-level view. You're one of the huge proponents for unschooling, and you're awesome. What are you seeing out there in the world? You said you're going to London, or you went to London. Can you give us a kind of what you see, what you've seen, and kind of like what you project? Because I'm getting very excited about the whole movement and everything like this. So what are you seeing, and what do you see in the next few years?
I mean, I've been advocating traveling around, speaking about this since 2006. So it's been almost 10 years, and what I see as human beings that all have the same dream for their families and hope for their kids. And it's just like being here being anywhere else I've gone. But in Australia, Australia was different. It was outside in the grass with naked babies crawling all over the place, and parents just so passionate about it. And, you know, in England, it was amazing. And Canada, all I can say is that it's no different than sitting here with you. People are people. But what I'm seeing is definitely a huge growth in the movement. There was a period of time last year where a lot of Germans contacted me. I get a lot of people contact me in countries where it's illegal because they try to control people and you forbid things, man. Nothing like raising a movement in those countries. It's illegal in Germany, so in the world, wherever it's illegal or more regulated, it's more prominent, which is really fascinating to me. But everywhere in the world, Japan, a couple people from Japan have contacted me, teachers, in fact, that want to have me out there talking about it to other teachers, which I thought was really cool, considering it's in a country that education is extremely highly valued. Success is measured in those grades and so forth. Yeah, what I'm seeing is the world's shifting towards more peace. I see it. Thank you guys so much for having me. You're awesome. If anybody wants to connect, I'm easy to find. You can find me on Facebook. If you want to schedule any kind of private coaching, I'm always available for that. And I'll be around the whole weekend, so if you see me and you have a question, just grab me. I'm happy to answer it.
Thank you so much, Dayna.
Free go on to be very successful entrepreneurs. So we'll talk about that.